Good morning, everyone. Welcome and thank you so much for tuning in. We're just going to get started in a few minutes. And before we do, while you're waiting, I just want to go over a few housekeeping. We are going to be respectful of your time. And so we want you to be reassured that we will begin promptly at 12 o'clock noon. If your microphone is not on mute, please do so. We'll also be offering a Q&A session and options and comments that you can participate in during the session. Comments, if you have questions or comments directed to a particular panelist, we ask that you message that individual panel member directly by utilizing the chat feature and then selecting their names. If you're offering a comment or a question that you want to be seen publicly, we then ask that you please use the large group chat option, which again, if you haven't selected a panel to connect with previously, then you don't have to do anything. If you have, then you have to select the everyone option to ensure that everyone that's on this session is able to see your questions and or your comments. We also want to inform you that this session is being recorded, and we hope that we'll have the opportunity to send it out to you if your coworkers are not able to attend today. So in the meantime, we're going to ask you to participate in a short, simple poll, and we're going to have the poll, which is up, and the question that we want you to consider and respond to is, what does diversity, equity, and inclusion mean to you? So it's 11:57 now, and we will begin, as I said earlier, promptly at noon. Thank you. All right. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for staying on and joining us. I'm Cheryl Hayward. I am a part of the Office of Diversity and Equity here at Monroe County. But before we begin, I want to again go over some housekeeping information for those who have just joined us and missed our little informative housekeeping notes earlier. So please mute your microphone if you find that you're not muted or you have the option to mute or unmute. Please mute your microphone. That way that will minimize this feedback that we all receive and we can clearly hear what's going to be said this afternoon. We're also offering the opportunity for questions and comments throughout this 1 hour long session. So for those that have questions that they want to direct to a panel member, please message that individual panelist or multiple panelists directly using the chat feature. If you have comments and or questions that you are comfortable with having the large group see and access and possibly give feedback to, we encourage you to use the large group chat option. If you, just a note, if you message a panelist individually or selected a couple of people, in order to use a large group chat feature, you will need to go in and select everyone. That will ensure that your comment or your question is able to be seen by everyone that's attending this session this afternoon. This session is being recorded, and we hope that we can have it available to you at a later date so that you can access it again and or invite your coworkers or partners that have not had the opportunity to join us this afternoon. Earlier, I also invited those that were already signed on to participate in a poll, and we're going to put that poll up once again for those who did not have the opportunity to provide input. And the question is, what does D, diversity, equity, and inclusion mean to you? So you'll see that poll happening. But before we begin, I really want to take this opportunity as well to thank and our ASL interpreters, Barb Dietz and Ashley Brand, who are joining us this afternoon. So thank you guys for making yourself available. Alicia, for joining us this afternoon.
You're welcome.
Okay. All right, can you move to the next slide? All right. Well, welcome. Hopefully you've had the opportunity to participate in the poll. I'm just going to briefly go over our agenda for our time together this afternoon. We're going to start with a welcome from County Executive Adam Bellow. Then Dr. Deanna Kimbrel is going to provide an introduction of the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion and share with you some of her vision, her mission, and the passion for this work and what that looks like happening in Monroe County. She's going to define diversity, equity, and inclusion in correlation to what you told us, what you believed it was in the poll that we asked you to participate in just a few moments ago. We're also going to give you some information about what's happening in June in regards to the DE&I world and its focus and all its focuses. And then we're going to have the opportunity for a question and answer segment. As you registered, we asked you to send us some questions. What information do you not have? Do you want us to know things that you want to be said or want to be answered? So we'll be given the opportunity to respond to some of those questions. And then Dr. Deanna Kimbrel will go over some next steps about what to expect from the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. And so I will introduce County Executive Adam Bellow.
Great, thank you, Cheryl. Thank you and the team and Dr. Kimbrel for putting today's town hall meeting together and bringing apart together so many people throughout our county departments to hear the good work that you're doing and the ways that we can all interface and work together. As many of you know from the outset here, a core priority of my administration going back to last year has been to ensure that our county government reflects the diversity of our community and serves our entire community equitably. And this new department that we created that is run by Dr. Kimbrel, I think is a very necessary first step to creating a more diverse and inclusive county government and ensuring that we are in a good business partner within the community. This wide encompassing department includes an equal employment opportunity manager, a staff development and ADA manager, and an MWB contracts specialist, and will perform a number of tasks and trainings and work with each of you to really bring a renewed focus to on effective methods and procedures for recruitment, selection, placement, and promotion for people across across our community and also across our government here. So, you know, the work of this department is also a great complement to the work of the Commission on Racial and Structural Equity, the Race Commission, that the county and the city of Rochester launched last year, that served us with a report just a couple months ago with a number of recommendations. And I think that working with Dr. Kimbrel and the team to implement a number of those recommendations and work through that, I think will serve our community and again the county government here very well. So this is really a great opportunity for everyone to meet Dr. Kimbrel, the full team here, learn more about what the department is doing, how you can work collectively with the team here to have the greatest impact, and answer any questions that you may have. So with that, I'll turn it back over to the team, and I hope you get a lot out of this presentation, as I'm sure we all will. So thank you very much.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Adam. I am so happy to be here, and I really want to thank you for your vision and implementation of this office as we are working to, as you said, implement change around the way in which we recruit, we promote, and create a culture of DE&I here at the county. So thank you so much for creating that vision and entrusting that vision with me and my team. And I just want to give my team some time to introduce themselves and who they are. And I'll tell you guys a little bit about me. I come to you here at Monroe County by way of corporate America from organizations like Paychex, Sears, and Target, and companies of that nature, building structure and strategy around organizational culture, diversity, equity, and inclusion. I've also worked in higher education at some institutes that you guys may be familiar with, like RIT and MCC, and things of that way. So very excited to be here and really start to be strategic and be intentional around the way we think about diversity, equity, and inclusion. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Ms. Medley, who is our admin assistant at the office.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Amber Medley. I am Dr. Kimbrel's Executive Administrative Assistant. I have been with Monroe County just a few months, and I look forward to all the work that we will be doing to expand all of our diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives.
And good afternoon once again, everyone. I am Cheryl Hayward, also new to Monroe County, and I'm serving in the role of the Equal Employment Opportunity Manager, as well as transitioning some of the responsibilities of the ADA manager as well. So just to give you a bit of background, I am a certified mediator. My career has been in community advocacy, working with marginalized communities, police oversight, as well as conflict management. And so my role as the EEO Opportunity Manager is really to provide an environment where we can proactively address some issues relating to discrimination, harassment, hostile work environment, or any workplace issue that you feel may be detrimental. And so our goal is to really look and see how we can support you, support in giving you the resources you need, and mitigate any issues that may lead to an investigation or even worse, moving up to the federal level in terms of a complaint. So I look forward to working with you all collectively, building relationships, and just really ensure that you have what you need to have a great day at work.
I'm going to Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ebony Burgess, and I'm the Staff Development and ADA Manager here in the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Office. I've been with the county for 14 years in several capacities. My most recent capacity was a supervisor in DHS and also the president of the Federation of Social Workers. In my role as Staff Development Manager, I look forward to working with the leadership team, helping them to gain resources so that they can better lead effective teams and giving their staff the tools and resources that they need to get to the next level. We're also planning on doing a mentorship program, which is allow you to pour into your staff, making sure that they have everything that they need from doing mentoring, leadership academy, just really making sure that all staff have the tools and resources that they need within Monroe County. So I look forward to working with each and every one of you, and you know, we'll be in contact.
Okay, so I will speak on behalf of Jesus and Matt, which is our Language Access Compliance Coordinator and our MWBE Specialist. Jesus will be ensuring that we are compliant and intentional around the way in which we provide information and content for those who are limited English proficient. And Matt will be ensuring that we are more diverse in the way in which we work with minority women and minority and women businesses as well. So we will be talking more with them next time, but unfortunately they aren't here this time to introduce themselves, but absolutely great additions to the team. And thank you ladies for all of your introductions. And now I wanna also turn it over to Dr. Candace Lucas, who also sits in the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion.
Thank you, Dr. Kimbrel. Hi everyone, I am Candace Lucas. I'm filling a newly created position of Chief Community Engagement Officer. While I'm not officially part of the ODEI office, we do have a lot of synergies with the work that I will be doing as the county executive mentioned on the RAISE Commission and all of the recommendations that we received from that. In addition to that, I will also be working with our community as a whole to understand what their concerns are, what their needs are, see how we can better engage and empower them to be active in government and making sure that we are able to address their concerns to the best of our ability and ensure that those gaps are filled that may have been left unfilled for some time. So I'm looking forward to the work that I'll be doing with the ODEI office, as well as with many of the departments as we look to implement the recommendations that came out of the RAISE report. Thank you.
All right, well, thank you so much, Dr. Lucas. I want to also give you guys a little more detail into who we are as an office or who we are evolving to be and the role in which we will play here at the county. As you guys know, we are brand new in the newest office here at Monroe County, and I'll say about 20 or so years, and Adam can keep me honest with that, but this is really the first time in several decades in which the county has implemented a new department. And as I've been hearing, as I've been meeting with a lot of the departments, it is overdue and much needed. So some of our mission or some of the things that we will be focused on is ensuring that we are recruiting, retaining, and promoting people of diverse backgrounds. As we know, and the reason as to why we are here today, people of diverse backgrounds usually get marginalized. Therefore, it is important that organizations, all organizations, have an intentionality around ensuring that they, number one, have representation, and that representation is properly mobile throughout the organization into professional and leadership roles. One of our other goals is to ensure that DE&I is a part of the culture and the fabric here at the county. And it is something that is tangible, something that people can speak to, and there's evidence of that. We also want to ensure that there is equity and access in everything that we do, whether it is internal to our employees or external to the people in the community in which we serve. We also will be developing a cadence of education around culture and bias. And this is the first step in doing that and ensuring that we are consistent and we are intentional around the way in which we hear your voice and also educate you around differences. We are also ensuring that we are properly investigating and addressing issues as it relates to discrimination, harassment, and a hostile work environment. And it's really our goal to create trust throughout the workforce so you guys can feel safe to have conversations with us in regards to your experience. The Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion is a safe space to learn your rights, share your experiences, and get feedback. The vision is for this office is to create more diverse, equitable, and inclusive systems, workforces, and communities where everyone has the ability to thrive. And our purpose is to be intentional around valuing the differences that contribute to the knowledge sharing, the decision-making, and the distribution of access and opportunity. So I know that we have some big shoes to fill, but we are definitely here and we are definitely up for the challenge. And we want to partner with each and every one of you guys to make sure that we are making your experiences better and you have the opportunity to thrive in this environment, no matter what your diversity is. So I want to kind of go to the question that we posed earlier and kind of see what you guys said. The question was, what does diversity, equity, and inclusion mean to you? Is it ageism? Is it sexism? Is it classism? Is it racism? Or is it all of the above? Let's see what you guys said. You guys said all of the above 100%, and you are 100% correct. Diversity, equity, and inclusion is going to include all of our differences, whether it be our race, our age, our gender, our socioeconomic status, what have you. It is everything that makes us different, but also those things that make us the same. So some of our differences show up on us, right? So our gender, our race, and those different things show up on us, but there are also some things below the line that we can't see, such as our socioeconomic status, or maybe our mental health status, or our family makeup. Those things don't show up for us. However, they should be considered in the way in which we work and interact with each other. When we think about equity, we think about our intentionality to support the differences that exist and create more fair environments. And traditionally, when people think about fair, they are thinking about giving everybody the same thing at the same time, right? But when we are equitable, we are considering the differences that exist and what do individuals need in order to thrive? How do we make this workplace a place in which they enjoy coming, they feel safe, and then they also feel as though they have room to grow if they wish to? And inclusion is what an organization does, the actions that it takes to ensure that everyone feels welcome. So, and that's a lot of the culture. When you come into the organization, do you feel as though this is a place that you belong? Do you feel as though this is a place that you are respected and considered? And those are all the things we want to be intentional around. Not to say they aren't happening, but we want to make sure that we are intentional around these things and ensuring that they are happening each and every day. So I want to share a quote with you that was shared with me some time ago, just to understand the difference between DE&I. And often when people hear DE&I, they kind of lump all of those things together as though it is one term, but these are actually three different terms that mean different things. So diversity, for example, is being invited to the party. Inclusion is being asked to dance. And equity is having a voice in the planning of the party. Okay, so it kind of shows us that we have to be there. We have to have representation. But when we get there, how will we feel? And when we have a voice in the way in which things will happen and decisions are made in the organization, okay? And I usually relate it to when I was a kid and, you know, people would get invited to parties and parents would say, you have to invite everybody. But if you get there and nobody talks to you, is it worth being there? And if you get there and they don't play the music that you like, is it worth being there? And that's the same thing here. We wanna have representation. We wanna make sure people are included and what we do, and they have a voice. All right, and I just wanna let everybody know we are in this together. Usually when we hear DE&I, people think it's a race thing, it's a gender thing, it's a LGBTQ thing. No, no matter who we are and what your background is, we all will experience a certain level of being different. And no matter who you are or where you come from, you all have biases. We all have biases. It is a part of the human nature. And those are some of our barriers to being more inclusive. Okay. And no matter who you are, you have been impacted in some way by inequities in our society. Okay. And there's several things that get in the way of us being diverse, equitable, and inclusive. And many of these things are out of our control, but there's also many of things that are in our control if we pay particular attention to those things. So when we think about our ability to trust others, when we think about our ability to understand differences that exist within others, when we think about our lack of education around differences in culture and history in our society, when we think about the biases that we have or those that are perpetuated in the media or, you know, different things like that, as well as how we are communicating, which are our microaggressions and how our biases manifest. And there's also how are we managing the conflict that we have as they come up, as they relate to our differences? And then how do we build stronger relationships in order to be more impactful around DE&I? So these are some of the things that our office will be addressing in our vision to get more proficient around these things as we are becoming more diverse, equitable, and inclusive. Okay, and one thing I just wanna leave you guys with before I turn it over to Cheryl, who will be giving you guys some background on Juneteenth, and will also be giving you some background on Pride Month, is that DE&I is really an experience, right? So depending on who you are, you will experience diversity, equity, and inclusion different. And I think we had a question come in through when we sent out the survey, who will be defining it? It will look and feel different for everyone based on the work that you do, based on your background, based on the connotations that you attach to your experiences. So it will be different for everyone. I gave you guys some textbook definitions, but the way in which it will show up will be different for everyone. And we hope to be inclusive of those experiences. It is our goal and our mission. Okay, so I'm gonna turn things over to our EEO manager, Cheryl, to talk to you more about Juneteenth.
I'm back. So what's happening in the month of June? I'm sure you guys have been hearing this word Juneteenth, probably a lot more in the last year and a half or two than most of you probably have. So Juneteenth is really a celebration of the African-American cultural tradition of music, food, and freedom. Why freedom, you may be asking. So on June 19th in 1865, Juneteenth, which is a play on the date, June and the 19th, Juneteenth, marks the date that Union Army General Gordon Granger arrived in Galveston, Texas, and announced to enslaved African Americans of the end of both the Civil War and slavery. Now, why is this so surprising? It's surprising because the Emancipation Proclamation that happened 2.5 years earlier on January 1st, 1863, had legally freed many of the slaves. These were the Southern slaves that had not had that news. So it's good news, right? Juneteenth happened. Juneteenth has become a celebration throughout the Americas, where it's become really one of the most celebrated emancipation, Freedom Day, as some people refer to it, event that again, it freed enslaved African-Americans. Juneteenth has been celebrated beginning in 1866. So over 150 years, although it may seem like a new thing, a new event, it really hasn't been. It's been celebrating in communities with community-centric events such as parades, cookouts, prayer gatherings, historical and cultural readings, as well as musical performances. Now, as a result, because the event did happen in Texas, with the Great Migration, a lot of families that immigrated from the South, from Texas, they brought the Juneteenth celebrations with them. And so throughout many African-American communities, this has been a staple in their community, maybe in their families and in their cultural norms. How did it now become something that most people recognize to be an annual event? And some people are just learning that it's an annual event? Well, in 1980, Texas recognized and became the first state to recognize Juneteenth as an official state holiday and the first state to grant this emancipation celebration. As a result, over 48 other states, not 48 other states, including the District of Columbia, has recognized the Juneteenth momentous event as a state holiday. Just last year in October, New York State became the last states currently that also named this and recognized this event as a state holiday. So as the conversation has been happening about what does freedom look like, how do we celebrate it? It's moved from community conversations to statewide conversations to now federal level government conversations. And on June 17th in 2021, the federal government recognized officially Juneteenth, June 19, 1865, as its official 11th federal holiday. Now, this is the first holiday added to the list since 1983. 1983 was 37 years ago. And the last holiday was in recognition of the work that Martin Luther King did. So we had Dr. Martin Luther King's Day. A flag raising ceremony was held in front of the Monroe County office building on June 18th, commemorating the new federal holiday. So it's a great thing for our community, for our country, and we hope that Monroe County will be able to develop something grand next year. But I want you to really be mindful that Juneteenth wasn't the only thing that had immediately garnered freedom for enslaved slaves. There was the Reconstruction Amendment, so the 13th Amendment, the 14th Amendment, the 15th Amendment that are continually developing and providing additional freedoms to descendants of enslaved African Americans, but you know, current community. So you're probably wondering, why is Juneteenth important to me? I think really, just in a nutshell, it's not just a time for celebration, but I think Juneteenth represents a time for everyone to just pause and really think about the meaning and the manifestation of freedom. And what does freedom look like and how is it defined in our country for people of color everywhere, people with disabilities, people with aging. So anything that falls under an opportunity to discriminate, what does freedom really look like? But it's really important because I think Juneteenth is for everyone. Everyone who believes in freedom and everyone who believes in creating a new world where we can all recognize, respect, share, and celebrate our differences. But again, celebrate the true meaning of freedom. So thank you. Hopefully that gave you a little bit nugget of Juneteenth, that it gets you excited about what that means to the communities that it impacts and how you can support that impact as well. And so I'm going to turn it over now to Ebony. Ebony is going to give you some more information about some great things that happened during the month of June that we celebrate.
Well, hello, everyone. I just wanted to go over 5 facts about the history of LGBTQ Pride Month as we come to an end celebrating Pride. So did you know that there was a gay rights movement before Pride Month? There's a storied history of LGBTQ activism in the United States that dates back long before the Stonewall riots. In 1924, Henry Gerber, a German immigrant, founded the Society for Human Rights in Chicago. It was the first group to campaign for gay rights in the United States. And in 1955, the Daughters of Bilitis was founded in San Francisco and became the first lesbian rights group in the United States. In the 1960s, the Mattachine Society would hold its annual reminder at Philadelphia's Independence Hall every 4th of July, where they'd advocate for lesbians and gay equality. Did you know that the Stonewall riots was not America's first LGBTQ uprising? In May of 1959, a group of LGBTQ individuals who were fed up with being mistreated by the police revolted at Cooper Donuts in Los Angeles. According to the 2015 article in Out Magazine, the group, which was led by several transgender women, pelted officers with donuts, coffee, and paper plates until they were forced to retreat and return in larger numbers. It is the first documented LGBTQ uprising in U.S. history. Did you also know that the first gay pride parade was held in Chicago? Most people know that pride commemorates the Stonewall Uprising and that the first pride marches, which was more militant and liberationist and less celebratory and corporate than today's events. It took place in 1970 to mark the first anniversary of Stonewall. While the Christopher Street Gay Liberation Day March in New York City is widely considered to be the first pride parade, it actually occurred one day after Chicago held its first march, which technically makes Chicago the birthplace of gay pride. Also, did you know that the pride flags have their own interesting histories? The rainbow flag, now a ubiquitous symbol of the LGBTQ community, first appeared in the 1970s. Harvey Milk, the first open gay elected official in the US, tasked artist and activist Gilbert Temple for the gay community to use in place of the pink triangle, which Nazi Germany forced the white flag in 1978, dyeing the fabric himself. The transgender pride flag similarly arose from a challenge as its creator, Monica Helms, told Atlanta Magazine last year. The creator of the bisexual pride flag, Mike Page, challenged Helms to create a flag for the transgender community. Helms said, one day she woke up with the idea for the colors, which was the traditional color light blue for boys, pink for girls, and a single white stripe for those who are transitioning gender neutral or intersex. The flag was first flown at Phoenix Pride in 2000. In 2014, Helms' original flag was donated to the Smithsonian National Museum of American History. You also know in 2018, Daniel Kazar designed the Progress Rainbow. The new design adds 5 new colors to emphasize progress around inclusion. The flag includes black and brown stripes to represent people of color, and baby blue, pink, and white, which are used to transgender pride flag. Also, did you know that Bill Clinton was the first sitting U.S. president to officially recognize Pride Month? On June 11, 1999, President Bill Clinton issued a proclamation number 7203. It was the first time a U.S. president had officially recognized June as Gay and Lesbian Pride Month. Clinton's successor, President George W. Bush, did not recognize Pride Month during his 8 years in office. President Barack Obama, however, followed Clinton's example, making Pride Month and expanding it to include bisexual and transgender Americans. Every year he was in office, and President Donald Trump did tweet about Pride Month in 2019, but he never really officially recognized the month. On June 1st, 2021, President Joe Biden, White House issued a proclamation recognizing June as Pride Month, which noted that during LGBTQ plus Pride Month, we recognize the resilience and determination of many individuals who are fighting to live freely and authentically. In doing so, they are opening their hearts and minds and laying the foundation for a more just and equitable America. The Pride Month, we affirm our obligation to uphold the dignity of all people and dedicate ourselves to protecting the most vulnerable amongst us. So that sums up, you know, our month of celebrating pride. And I just wanted to end with sharing the LGBTQ plus with the acronyms and what it stands for. So hopefully at your own leisure, you can go back and you can educate yourself about what the L stands for, the G, the B, the T, and the plus. Because by doing so, you get an understanding of the LGBTQ plus community and what all it entails. And hopefully you'll embrace this change and embrace a diverse group of people. And again, we just want to celebrate throughout this month. So thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Cheryl and Ebony. We really appreciate that education on Juneteenth and Pride Month. I mean, it is, those are some really, really important differences that we want to discuss. I think in the past, a lot of times, especially around Juneteenth, and we haven't discussed those things and we haven't really dug into our history to understand how it impacts us today. So when we understand our history, then we are less likely to repeat it. So thank you for sharing those historical accounts. And hopefully our audience has been able to take away some good things from that. I want to move on to your voice. So a lot of you have sent in questions and comments, and we want to give you the opportunity to be heard and kind of have your questions answered as well. So I'm going to start with those. And if we have time, we'll take some questions from the chat. If you guys have any additional questions, you can chat those in and we can take those questions live if time so permits. So the first comment is, I am so glad that there is an Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. As a deaf person working as a contact tracer, case investigator, temporary position, I was so happy to become a bridge in connecting the deaf hard of hearing community to our government in a public emergency situation. Thank you so much for that. It is the diversity that becomes our strength, and it will help to foster trust between the government and community at large. That is a wonderful comment. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. The next question, and this question, I want to get some help from our county executive to answer this question, but it is, why isn't Juneteenth a paid holiday at MCH and many other county offices are observing it? Is he still on? We may have lost a connection with Adam, or maybe he had an emergency and needed to head out. But I'll go ahead and answer this question on his behalf. And the county executive does support this being a holiday, being a pay holiday. But as many of you guys know, there is also a process that we will go through, and we are currently going through as it relates to our contracts. So as we are negotiating our contracts, and this is the time of year in which this will happen, that will also be recommended to be a part of those contracts. So hopefully next year we'll be able to have a day off or make sure that we are observing that as a federal holiday. So thank you for that comment. How would you define ageism is the next question. And as it relates to ageism, and as we spoke about earlier, all of the isms, sexism, racism, classism, all of those things, we want to kind of look at them the same way. And it is when you are treated differently or being limited in your opportunities or access because of a difference that you have or because of a particular diversity that you have, whether it is your age, whether it is your disability status, whether it is your race. And it really will be defined based on the federal law. So as it pertains to color, race, gender, national origin, age, disability, sexual orientation, marital status, creed, military status, your gender identity, criminal history, so forth and so on, are the things in which we consider to be a discrimination violation. Okay, so thank you for that question. And we'll have more opportunities for you guys to learn around discrimination, harassment, and how you can spot it as well as know your rights. Is disability considered a form of diversity? Yes, it is considered a form of diversity. We've seen that in your polls. Anything that is making us different, whether we can see it or not, can be considered a form of diversity. The next question, do you plan to implement a countywide education intensive training to create a culture of anti-racism? Yes, we will be creating a library of different trainings and a cadence of education around those things that everyone in the county will have access to. It will hit on racism, but just as we spoke about ageism, it will hit on all of the diversities that exist within our workforce. So we will be talking about racism, ageism, sexism, ableism, and all of those different things that make people different. And we may not call it anti-racist training, but there may be a segment that will focus on anti-racism. When we think about racism, and I think the root of this question is just ensuring that we are willing to talk about racism. And I think that's a number one priority for us. When we are able to talk about racism and we are able to implement strategies to mitigate the impact of racism, we are also doing that for all of the other isms as well, all of the other protected classes, just given the unique nature of race and the way in which it plays in our society. So as we talk about that, we'll be talking about all the different isms and making sure that we have strategies in place to reduce the impact of those in our daily interactions. All right, so some additional questions that you guys had. Good day. I just want to know what efforts have been made to identify social determinants that may result in certain outcomes or caused by the relation to a certain ethnic group when providing services to community members. And this is a great question, and I think it is something that we have been working to solve for as a community. So this is something that is really bigger than the county. It is something that we will focus on as a community and continue to support this and continue to partner with the right people to reduce the impact of this in our community. So this is an ongoing project, just like DE&I, as you guys know, it is a journey. So it is something that we will continue to support, continue to bring awareness to, and continue to understand how we can reduce and mitigate the impact of these things in our society. Okay, next question. Do we have trainings in microaggressions or how implications based on implicit bias can present barriers to wellness and providing care? And again, that question is yes. We plan to develop a library of trainings that is accessible by everyone in the county to learn more around microaggressions, how they get in the way of us being our full selves. We know that there is psychological safeties associated with the lack of inclusion, and we'll be able to educate around that and how it impacts people just doing their job. I think what makes the county so unique is that we have a group of great people who are delivering services every day and they are pouring into our community. We also want to make sure that you have the tools and resources to be recharged so that you can be well to do the jobs that you do and pour back into the community. All right, so next question, will there be any changes to the way county approaches work-life balance in the future? I feel like the current inflexible scheduling policies affect people with disabilities very negatively. Many people with disabilities come to work when they have colds and flus and spread them because they use all their sick time for a doctor's appointment. I mean, this is a great question, especially as we are starting to creep out of the pandemic. We want to make sure that people that are sick stay home and they don't bring it into the workplace just because they need to, meet their hours for their pay. So there is definitely flexibility happening, and the attendance policy is actually in the process of being reevaluated and going through the proper vetting processes. Once that has been completed, it will be negotiated with the unions as well. So we will be making sure that the way in which we look at work-life balance is going to be a little bit different. We are suspecting that those changes will probably take place by the new year. So it is something that we are actively working to bring light to, as well as change the way in which it looks in the county. Mm-hmm. You can go ahead and say it. All right, so now we'll take some time to answer a few of your questions that you guys put in the chat. Some of the questions we may be able to answer. Some of them we may have to have you refer to our email address so that we can follow up with a more accurate and detailed answer. But Amber, I'm going to go ahead and have you read the first question.
How can we handle receiving phone calls from individuals who do not speak or understand the English language? Can the county provide interpreters?
Absolutely. So earlier you guys heard me mention Jesus, which is our language access coordinator, and he is working with each department to ensure that they have the proper tools, resources, and procedures. So when these events arise, we can address them properly and make sure that those people have the information that they need and is readily available. Okay. Any other questions you guys may have for us? Yep, you can feel free to use the Q&A feature or you can put it in the chat. Okay, if someone raised their hand, let's see, we can probably unmute you, Basil, so that you can be heard. Let's see. We have to find you. Oh, there's Basil. Okay. Give us 1 second. We're going to see if we can unmute you. Okay. I don't know what happened. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not sure what happened, but I think we lost the question. Is it possible for you to chat it in for us, please? Okay, so while we wait for that question, we have another from Omar. A follow-up to that question, with the DE&I department assist with translation of county documents? Absolutely. Each department should have the resources to translate documents. And I'm going to get back to you on that, Omar, to be for sure. However, we want to make sure that the documents are translated and working with the departments to ensure that that happens. So I'll get back to you for sure on 100% of that question, but all departments should have those resources to ensure that the proper documents are translated. We have an anonymous question. I really like the education session you did about Juneteenth and Pride. Will there be more of those types of opportunities? Absolutely, there will be more opportunities to learn. Every month, we will hold this forum to hear your voice as well as educate you on differences. So there will be providing educational material in several different modalities, and this is our first way of doing that. Do these changes affect, this is another question for Coleman. Do these changes affect Monroe County Hospital? Yes, everything that we are talking to you guys about today will be implemented across all Monroe County departments. Oh, and how will they, we're working to ensure again around the recruitment, the hiring and the promotion, as well as creating a culture of DE&I, ensuring language access, and also addressing issues as they arise related to DE&I. Okay, great question. When microaggressions take place, what is the protocol being developed to address these incidents? And that's a great question. And for those who don't know what a microaggression is, it is those subtle things that happen when we are communicating that reveals our biases that we have. So let me give you an example. Someone may say, oh, you're really smart for a woman, or, you know, different things like that, where they may not understand the impact or the negative impact it may be having on someone, and they may mean well, but it communicates a bias and can get in the way of people communicating and developing relationships. And that's something that we want to educate people on across the county, as well as ensure that it is happening. So we do want to hold people accountable for being respectful in their communication, as well as being intentional around differences. Okay.
Many of my employees chose not to attend this session today. What suggestions do you have to engage all employees?
All right, great, great question. So as you guys know, this is voluntary and this is really for you to be heard and share your thoughts and opinions. This isn't required. However, we will have other trainings and other things that will be required where we will need everybody to participate. But I think by sharing your experiences and sharing what you got out of it will motivate people to come around and be involved and take the time to attend these meetings with us. So I think it's just a matter of people learning the value of them over time. Okay, I have another one here. Thank you for this town hall session. Can you please explain what type of training your office will provide to employees as it relates to DE&I. So there will be a menu that we will create, but there will be several trainings. So just to name some off the top of my head, we will start with the organizational training that will set the expectation around DE&I. We will have a bias training. We will have leadership training to help leaders become more inclusive. We will have trainings to help you learn more about discrimination and harassment and hostile work environments. So there will be several different trainings that will be available to you. And what will be unique about these trainings is that they will be bite-sized, so you won't have to sit down for 2 hours to take a training, maybe 20 to 30 minutes to take each training. We are hoping that we can make these trainings on demand as well as mobile for you guys as well. Yeah, and that's a really good question. We want to make sure that we are not only touching our employees, but we are also touching those that interact with the county as well. So many of the services and the education that we will be providing will be available for our contract employees, but these things may change based on the department. So it will really depend on the department, but as much as we can, we will make all of these efforts available to contracted employees as well. Okay, Randy, so we have Randy who's raised his hand. Unfortunately, in this webinar mode, we are not able to unmute. However, we would really love for you to go ahead and put your question in the chat. We will make this PowerPoint available to you as well as the recording. So when we send out the recording, we will also send out this PowerPoint. Please, please, please share. As you guys know, word of mouth is going to be a big thing, and just sharing your experience and what we're doing is going to really help forward this initiative across the county. Do you plan to make the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion benchmarks transparent to employees and the community? Absolutely. That is one of our major, major initiatives to ensure that we have this information as to what we're doing, how we're doing it, and what progress looks like available to the workforce as well as the community. We are working on a dashboard and working on how that would look and how that will be presented, but that is a top priority for us and also something that was recommended by the race report. Okay, Michelle, please feel free to type in your question. Any other questions, any other thoughts, comments that you guys may have? We'll take them now. Gotcha. All right, I mean, you guys are good. I really, really appreciate the questions. These questions are spot on and very, very valid. We will have an opportunity for you guys to continue to pose your questions. Thank you, Kara. She said it was great. Thank you. To continue to pose your questions, your insights, and your experiences. So we really want to know what's going on so that we can do what it will take to ensure that our environment is more diverse, equitable, and inclusive. So let's go over a few of the next steps that we want you guys to be thinking about as it relates to our office. We are going through the process of understanding the county. What are the experiences? What do the different departments face and how can we help them? So this is really our exploration phase. And we ask that you guys complete all surveys and be engaged as possible so we can really, really understand the state of diversity here at the county and what we can do, what steps and strategies we can put in place to ensure that we are implementing real change. You can also expect from us consistency around monthly awareness insights and town hall meetings. We will also be working with each department to develop diversity action plans. We will have a focus on developing a culture of DE&I throughout the county. And we will be providing you all with tools and resources to help people of diverse backgrounds thrive as employees, as leaders, and service providers throughout the county. I just ask that you guys continue to stay tuned, stay connected, and stay engaged. Before we sign off, guys, I see that there's two final questions that we'll take. What advice do you have to employees who feel burned out and like the county has a lot to do? And you know what? You are right. The county has a lot to do. Think about where we came from. This is the first time since the county has been developed in hundreds of years that they had this focus. So there's a lot of work that we have to do. There is a journey, but what is great now about our county executive is that he is committed to doing the work. And that is the commitment that we need to forward that work. So it seems like it will be a lot to do, but we are on this journey. And every day, every month, every year, we will continue to get better around that. Do you believe each division within the county would have their own DE&I officers on site in the future? Some of the departments that are larger may have and have already started to implement having their own DE&I person or a liaison. I think that's a wonderful idea. And I also think that it's important for all county departments to at least have a committee or people that will focus on this for their department. And that's something that we will ensure and support that it happens. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for your questions. You guys have been great. We want to get better around this. So please just make sure that you are sending in your questions, your insights, and your suggestions. And until next time, thank you. Oh, and we have our contact page. Yep. Any questions that you have, any more comments, make sure that you are connecting with us there. And we intend to be highly collaborative with all of the departments. Okay. Thank you guys. Enjoy the rest of your day.